then the whole surah ends with this scene out of this world. Look at this now. 283 to 286. Read 283, please, to me. Read 283. To Allah belongs what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. And whether you disclose what's in your chest or keep it concealed, you're held accountable. You know what that means, Amir? That when you think about something haram here, you're guilty. You did it, as if you did it. Right? Imagine the companions, by the way, came to the Prophet, they did like this. They did like this. جثوا على الركب حديث أبي هريرة صلى الله عليه وسلم. They said, يا رسول الله, we were commanded to pray. We said, سمعنا وأطعنا. We were commanded to, سمعنا وأطعنا. They named certain, this one we can't. Technically, it's really difficult. And now do not assume that the companions were rejecting the commands. We know that the attitude of the companions was always, they are after ihsan, attaining the highest level in the religion, that they excel in executing the commands. This one, quite frankly, is difficult. And just to give you a practical example of this, there is a verse in Surah Al-Hajj talking about the haram, which says, وَمَنْ يُرِدْ فِيهِ بِإِلْحَادٍ بِظُلْمٍ نُذِقْهُ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. One of the ways to translate or understand this verse, that if you are in the haram and if you think about haram things, you're guilty. You think about it. وَمَنْ يُرِدْ. And these situations happen, by the way, when you do tawaf, when it's so crowded, you know, females and males do tawaf together, right? Sometimes you find yourself stuck. Don't even think about it. No. Just to let you know that some of the companions moved out of Mecca. They went to Taif. They said, no, I don't want to handle this, no. So this is as if they understood this verse that for you to live in Mecca, this is the rule. They said, you know what? No, I'm just going to go to Taif. it's hard. For the Sahaba, they did not want to fall under the concept of falling short in fulfilling the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they came and they said no. In a very respectful way. You know what the Prophet said to them? Look at this. And that sums up the whole surah to you. You know what he said to them? Are you going to say exactly what the followers of the two books before you? I thought we're not going to follow that model. You see that model, they said what? We hear and what? And disobey. Are you going to do like them? Say what? سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Even to this one, say سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Look, just to show you, Amir, that they had a good intention. Abu Huraira, the narrator of the hadith, said what? فَزَلَّتْ بِهَا أَلْسِنَتُهُمْ. Their tongue slipped with it. Not from sleeping, but you know the slipping, you know? Yeah. Like, okay, say, you know, some people, they come, oh, I can't do this. But brothers, just say سَمِعْنَا وَطَعْنَا. Okay, Sheikh, سَمِعْنَا وَطَعْنَا, inshallah. You know, so they had no intention. They said سَمِعْنَا وَطَعْنَا. Jibreel comes down with what? With the relief. آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا. We hear and we obey. غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. Then the تخفيف came, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Again, emphasizing the three verses, the two qualities, you need to have in order to be what? In order to be like this man, not like this, not like this. Did we connect all of al-Baqarah or no? You see, that's the type of tafsir that we're going to do with every chapter of the Quran. Imagine this. Now, when you read this, the chapter, everything falls what? In place.